How you doing, everybody?
1999, the year the Big Day Out returned to the music calendar. It was the year Christian Democratic crusader Fred Nile protested against the inclusion of goth rocker Marilyn Manson.
He's got a sexual thing for him.
It was the year of superstar DJ Fatboy Slim, and it was the year that fun-loving criminals had it out with Underworld. 1999 also saw Australian bands Regurgitator, Powderfinger and the Super Jesus take to the main stage. And it was the year Korn provided the metal and Courtney Love provided the nudity.
Whatever.
Step through.
After a much-needed hiatus in 1998, the Big Day Out was back. The festival made its triumphant return in 1999 and found a brand new home in Sydney, the Olympic site at Homebush Bay. You'll never see me. By your
side, you'll never hear me. It didn't really get filled, and then I got shown in the Olympic site and went out with a hard hat and was wandering around while they're building everything. And I said, oh, well, let's try and do it again. You know, let's just try and change what we're doing and try and reinvigorate it. And the musical scene had moved on a bit, and even just the year gap allowed us to recharge a bit. And, you know, I found things like Marilyn Manson and Courtney to be very funny. I was hot. And that was a really fun comeback, because it was such great fodder for the media, with Fred Nile having a ball. And Marilyn having waiting for the visa. I mean, we had banner headlines in Queensland that Viv Fant and the publicist said, only God can stop him now. And so there's all these sandwich boards out there, because his visa had been approved, so trying to do the smoking bones and throwing babies and puppies, all this kind of stuff.
I'm good, yourself?
Wet.
You're wet.
Sit in the rain.
Ah, stop spitting! Hey, rain! Could it be God? Could it be Fred Nile?
It could be Fred Nile ejaculating on me. He's got a sexual thing for him. I think it's mostly because he's jealous. He wants to have his name in the paper as much as mine. Uh-huh. Next thing you know, he's gonna be wearing lipstick, so.
That would be great if you turned him onto lipstick.
This would be so bad.
Because Fred's kind of really quiet until someone as exciting as you comes along and he's like, wow, another opportunity to, like, tell people how the world is very evil. And
I think you should have picked on Courtney, though.
Yeah? Yeah. Why's that?
Well, I think she's, I'm bigger than Satan. Courtney is Satan. Get over
it! Courtney is Satan.
I think so, yeah.
Do your fans bring strange things to gigs?
Yeah, but, mostly prosthetic limbs, because I collect those, so a few times some kind gentleman would give me their legs, and stuff like that, and he'd have to hop home, but I got an arm also. So.
Do you think you might ever need them? Is that why you keep them?
I've just always been fascinated with medical things.
Uh-huh.
So as a kid, I was always sick.
That was the Big Day Out year of egos. You had Korn, Marilyn Manson and Hole. Courtney Love got helicoptered out to the Big Day Out. There was a lot of kerfuffle about who was where on the bill.
Now, even when we're putting the time sheets together, someone's going, oh, I don't want to play then because I actually want to see so-and-so. I think, well, the reason why you're playing there is you're totally different to that band. And going, oh, well, how about I swap it in one city? Go, oh, yeah, all right. So we're negotiating these, like, dinner parties. They're dinner parties. Oh, so-and-so wants to sit next to so-and-so. Oh, so-and-so's coming now, so I don't get on with them. And that happens a fair bit too. And that's, you only find that out when they get the sheet. And go, oh. And of course, the funniest one was, Underworld in 99, being punched out. Or Carl getting punched out by, was it Huey from Fun Loving Criminals? In between walking off stage and the encore.
So what's a band here that's on the lineup today that you really would like to take the time to go and see? in your busy agenda?
To be quite honest, we're very good friends with Ash, and they're always a fantastic group to see play live. They're good. We want to actually go see the Underworld play later.
Yeah,
we think that they actually, well, we have to talk with them about something, so, you know.
Oh, a bit of a conversation happening there.
And I was standing there in the boiler, and it's like, he comes on stage, and great gig, and we've gone crazy, and then this guy comes out of nowhere and just goes, King hit him right in the head. Knocked him out, right in the ground, getting him up, goes back, does the encore, and go, who the hell was that guy? And that was to do with, you know, girlfriend problems 3 years before. So then we had to keep him separated for the next week. He'd been waiting, stewing for 2 or 3 years. When he sees him, he's going to knock him out, you know?
Now, I think Nicole Kidman's a really good actress, but I just got rejected and Nicole Kidman got the part. And from an Australian, can we just support me, please, on that?
Since first appearing at the 1995 Big Day Out, Courtney Love had transformed herself from grunge queen to Hollywood starlet. The self-confessed diva was nominated for a Golden Globe later that year for her acting debut in The People vs. Larry Flynn.
Courtney, in 99, being arrested off Qantas flight for calling the stewardess a bitch. Because she missed the flight, of course, from Auckland to Melbourne. I think it was a direct flight then, and then because we went Auckland to Melbourne for some reason that year, I think routing issue. But I got the call from Stephen Pav because he was doing the show saying, do you know a good lawyer? And got my friend Bruno to do it and going, oh yeah, well, always wanted to be on the steps of the court saying, my client is innocent.
Courtney Love, she did an interview with, I think, Channel 7 News before us, and she sat down, she looked in the monitor, she went, I don't like that. I don't like that at all. This is over. So she stormed out of the interview, came and sat down with us, and luckily the cameraman, I think on the day, was Mike Jackson, and he, you know, he had the lights, he had it all good, had the monitor. She sat down and she went, oh, I like this.
See, your lighting's great. What's their problem? Okay, they don't even get us, all right, because their lighting is good. I hope you're filming this. A diva at work. Arr, darling.
I remember before the interview, we had to sign a disclaimer, which is kind of something that I never really heard about with Hollywood stars and that sort of stuff, and it was to guarantee that we wouldn't ask certain questions, and the questions included things like we weren't allowed to talk about Kurt Cobain, we weren't allowed to talk about Nirvana, we weren't allowed to talk about heroin, and we weren't allowed to talk to her children, about her children.
You know why we don't kiss much butt in England? They have to sign that crazy contract, and then I torture them, and I love torturing the British press. It's so not personal.
Yes, what a fun life! And so Jabba was doing the interview, and it was a fantastic interview, and it was a really open interview. And I think the highlight for me was we set ourselves this challenge where he was going to try and ask one of the questions you weren't allowed to ask, but do it in a way that she wouldn't know.
You know, got around it by asking about the Teletubbies, and so straight away she starts talking about the kids and you know, TV and stuff like that. So, you know, it's scary for those first 30 seconds, and then it's like you're just talking to someone.
You can see in Jabba's mind going, yes, I did it.
You should learn how to say no.
Coming up on BDO XV99, it's Courtney versus Marilyn in the Battle of the Egos. The 1999 Big Day Out was back with a vengeance, pulling crowds well over 200,000.
99 thing was kind of really weird, and kind of what we're trying to do is to work out what we're trying to do it if we can to go, well, 1 year is this, it needs to have a personality as an event, because we try to cast these things more or less like a movie. That's what I kind of say to people, I'm saying, well, some of the worst movies in the world are the ones with 10 stars in it. You know, and it's meant to be a whole experience. And that's a good lead segue into the whole. But, I mean, when Courtney, you know, kind of was the, to a certain extent, the, you know, who's going to close the show, we kind of armed and armed, and we thought, well, it'd be fantastic to have a girl close the show. Although Courtney's debatable on that front. Because she can be pretty nasty sometimes. But that whole, it was cabaret. you know, and it was fun. And it was a great show to bring back because it was full on entertainment. And it was a pleasure to do because the antics were so silly.
Well, I'll be the biggest dick and you can be the biggest boobs, dude.
You know, I think people missed it on film, but, you know, she's flying in by helicopter backstage was just annoying Marilyn and she mooned the audience from the chopper at the Gold Coast. So, you know, she's a classy girl. So that was, what can I say? But then again, that whole thing was meant to be a teaming up to do an American tour and only lasted about four shows because once they were off the big day out, those two big personalities couldn't get on.
I don't think I'm shocking at all. I think what I do is just entertaining. It brings a little excitement to the world of rock and roll. I think what shocks me is mostly Courtney's panty line. Because I've heard from several very reliable sources that it may go up as far as this.
I met Marilyn Manson at that Perth one. We'd made a video for this song, Don't Want to Be Left Out, where I was wearing all white or something and I'd had my face painted white and he had seen it on TV that morning and he thought it was hot because he's quite partial to makeup himself. You know, and he kind of, as I was walking past, he's like, hey man, I saw you on telly this morning. It's awesome, you know, it's a great clip. It's like Marilyn. Oh my God, Brian. Brian loves the fingers. Yahoo! Don't like the charts, but
the charts like me. Notorious entertainer Marilyn Manson certainly caused controversy during his 99 Big Day Out tour. The self-proclaimed Antichrist superstar had Christian leader Fred Nile up in arms. Nile attempted to have Manson denied entry to the country, labelling him a satanic pervert.
Well, what I discovered the other night when I was at Fred Nile's house, he was having a sermon with me and he said, Marilyn Manson, it's okay because Jesus Christ invented marijuana. And I said, really? And he said, Jesus Christ invented cocaine and LSD also. And I said, you know what, you're right, because if we're in God's world, then God invented drugs. And I said, you know what, if Jesus Christ can do drugs, then why can't we? And Fred said, you're right. That's when I can't speak about what happened after that.
Oh, okay.
Sexual nature.
It's probably the most circus mentality one we've had. And it was a circus coming to town thing with the, you know, the Fred Niles going nuts. And because that was, and I find it really funny that year because it was all to do with these people, you know, battling for media space with their own agendas. Now, Fred Nile just wanted media space. He didn't care. You know, that's his chance to really get on the front page and stuff. I mean, he's been waiting for stuff like that for years.
I would like to say in defense of the Christian religion that if there are nice things about it, there really are. And Marilyn can tear up the Bible all he wants, and I understand why, but there's good things in the Bible. Good things.
I've got a secret, actually. Marilyn Manson's got some tan. But he has to hide it underneath. He puts all his makeup on to cover it.
He just looks so funny, you know? He's got the feathers and the blue eyeshadow, and yeah, he had that weird feather outfit. And it's a big day out. It's like, you know, long shorts and keychains and corn and, you know, just kind of blokey blokes, and there's Marilyn Manson with the makeup running, and it's like, mate, you are a weirdo.
Marilyn Manson nearly pulls it all off because he smashes the guitar and he pulls the drums down and stuff like that. But I think the problem is that you know too much about what's about to happen with Marilyn Manson. Something would be good would be, say, John on stage doing something.
With his belly hanging out.
I don't know why, but I keep remembering this big day out with Marilyn Manson and Hole, and we were backstage somewhere. And I think they were just bored and they just started trashing shit in the backstage area, throwing chairs around and all that sort of stuff. And we were kind of, we had a band room right near them because it's in a kind of a quadrangle or whatever. And Darren, of all people, joined in, started throwing chairs around and smashing shit up. It was like, what's happened to this hippie? Oh my God. That was pretty funny.
99 marked Channel E's first major foray into shooting live performances with more than 10 full live sets filmed. The only band that denied us permission to film was Korn. But the metal was still represented in our broadcast, thanks to Max Cavalera's new incarnation, Soulfly.
We like the fact that we play when not much has happened yet. And I like the fact that people here, they actually come earlier to check out, which is cool, you know, it's like respectful. And we get the task to, for us, like we gotta work this crowd out, you know. Other bands later on, the people are already more drunk and stuff, it's easier to get into it.
What else do you do apart from music then? What are your other interests when you're not touring?
Cannibalism.
Cannibalism?
Yeah. Ever tried?
No.
You should, man. It's a really good stuff. It's hard when you start in the beginning, but once you get used to it, you keep it going, man. You can't stop it. Yeah.
Cooked flesh?
Cooked, yeah. No, raw flesh.
Yeah, we do it sashimi style, you know, sushi style. You know, it's all good.
A bit of wasabi, on a better rice.
Yeah.
Next on BDO XV99, we find out how Marilyn Manson reacts to getting hit with a bottle on stage.
Step two.
You guys are the best looking audience I've ever seen in my life. You're so attractive, you Australians.
Over the years, the Big Day Out Festival became a favourite with international acts, who often expressed their love of Australia during Channel E interviews or on stage.
Thank you very much, Sydney, the kids. Ah, oh, you smell beautiful and all that kind of stuff. You're gorgeous.
A song called Australia on your latest album. Is Australia a popular thing for you to think about?
It just always seemed like Mars, you know. It seemed somewhere you could escape from, and there's a certain time in our careers where we just wanted to escape somewhere. It's always somewhere I've been too scared to come because I don't like flying.
Oh my God, the next song we're going to play is an Australia song by, it's like the greatest f***ing pop song of the 80s anywhere internationally. If it had been written 5 years later, it would have been bigger than, thank you, it would have been bigger than f***ing anything. It's so good.
We're going to play a Hoodoo Guru song tonight, I think.
Mm-hmm. One of the Hoodoo Gurus is here in another band.
I know. And we asked him to, there were two Hoodoo Gurus here, and we asked him to play guitar because I, unfortunately, we just decided to do this song, Bittersweet, tonight, and because it's such a great song, right?
We're dancing.
Don't cry for a love gone wrong. Don't cry. Used to be my favorite song. Cry. He's so bittersweet.
You're here till the end of the Big Day Out tour? Yeah, we're doing the whole thing. So what's one thing you haven't done that you really want to get a bit of a tan? I'm trying.
Still, everyone just come up to me going, oh man, you better make sure you got some sunblock on.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know.
Quite Irish, guys.
The 1999 Boiler Room lineup also had everyone excited. Headlined by Fatboy Slim at the peak of his You've Come a Long Way Baby success, the dance music stage featured everyone from the Resid Dogs to Ronnie Size.
What's a band that you really admire that you want to see today that after your gig or before your gig you'd go and see?
The Boiler Room looks pretty good.
Yeah.
I like that Luke Slater, that Free Funk album. I wouldn't mind seeing just spin it, but
yeah.
I don't know, Fatboy Slim would be fun to dance to as well.
Yeah. You want to see Ronnie Size?
Yeah, maybe Ronnie Size as well. Sort of a bit of his stuff.
Yeah, the actual band, sweet.
They're not really our thing most of the time.
Yeah.
It's got a weak lineup in our opinion.
Yeah?
As far as the bands go, I don't know.
Well, you're a hard man.
I love the band Sparkle Horse. Good Morning Spider is a great album, but the one before it, the name of which I can't remember, is such a great long player. So I went to see them at the Boiler Room, what's that little room at the Melbourne Big Day? No, I can't remember. One of those little rooms, no one's in there. They're all waiting for fucking Eskimo Joe to come on or something. So here's this really brilliant band who are such accomplished musicians and heartbreaking songwriters, and the room's empty, and the lead singer can tell, and he's drinking Jack Daniels out of a a mug. And wow, what a show. But it was beautiful music. And I think that's one of the great things about the Big Day Out is sometimes, even at that huge spectacle, you walk into a room, there's no one there, and you have a really intimate moment. And that was what that Sparkle Horse gig in Melbourne was like for me, where it's just so, I was so close to the stage, I could see everything. And as I was walking out, there was a girl giving her boyfriend a blowjob in the corner. Like, that was just swept up in the moment of the music. And I guess, you know, they felt the intimacy in a different way, and they were expressing it together. And it was. I just thought, at least someone here is having fun, you know? Someone's getting some sex. It's not me, but, you know.
Oh, can I just, Tim, I'd just like to point out that...
Oh, yeah, I've been hanging out with Korn.
Yeah, that's very good. You've got to take it back to 1970 and burn things down and shake your hips and cuss.
That's from Manson.
Oh, okay.
That's his deal. We're just some white trash and brown trash from Bakersfield, which is boring, like, and we sit there and drink Coors Light. The colorful say.
Backstage at the event, it was all about partying, networking, and of course, Marilyn Manson.
Is it like that? Is it networking? Do you need to meet people to kind of, you know?
You don't need to, but you just do. You can't help it. You meet people and you go, oh, wow, you're from, you know, that band.
It's usually at the bar. That's where you meet. Yeah. It's usually at the bar.
Yeah, I've met many a rock star at the bar.
Have you met Marilyn?
No, Marilyn never comes out with us.
Oh, really?
Nah, I don't think he's yellow.
It's crack back there, let me tell you. Everyone's there. Everyone.
So how are you enjoying the Big Day Out so far?
Oh, it's a party.
Yeah?
It's a party. Tonight in particular is a very good evening for us. We're enjoying ourselves.
Marilyn Manson played in Perth, and I think someone chucked a bottle at him and hit him in the head or something, and there was a big nightmare going on. You know, he put on this big, I think he had a fight with someone in the crowd, something like that. Got down into the pit and went to biff with some guy who was apparently smashing him until he got dragged off by bouncers. And then, so we were all kind of backstage by the time he got back there. And there was an above ground swimming pool behind in the kind of band area, and he slashed it with a knife. So the whole place was just completely flooded. This is the end of the tour, and kind of, I suppose it didn't really make any difference, you know. That was the most kind of rock star moment, I suppose.
But I mean, the return of the show in 99 simply was a great chance for not only the audience to virtually a new generation when we came in, and it was kind of really weird because it was like it kind of got a very short term legendary status. I noticed that, you know, in Glastonbury Festival, when they were doing it, the best thing they could do was a year off to not only recharge the team, but, you know, to take it away, you know, like the childhood toy thing is you take it away from them before they get too bored with it, not after, because you can't get it back out of the cupboard again later. You want them to ask for it back, not you to say, do you want this thing still?
You got Korn, you got Manson, you got cars, you got monster trucks, and you got tits. You are fucking happy, man. You got your fucking money's worth. Don't tell me you didn't. I want to hear it.
Next time on BDO XV, we take a look back in time to the year 2000 Big Day Out with Red Hot Chili Peppers, Foo Fighters, Blink-182, and the Chemical Brothers.